Greetings, ladies and gentle players, and welcome this wonderful basics day of December of 2020, which just so happens to also be Christmas. So, Merry Christmas and Happy Holidays to everybody. Thought we'd start off today's video by going over some questions, because apparently some of you have been writing in asking to have some greater clarification in some of the videos that we've posted lately. So let's take a look at that. But first, something you can take a look at is Baduk.club. With almost 1,000 people gone and signed up onto Baduk.club so they can know where the Go clubs are around them, because, well, with the vaccine rolling out, it's only a matter of time now till we can all go back out like good little boys and girls and hit up those Go clubs, get playing in person. Apparently, unless you're in the Sudan, then you're kind of out of luck. Sorry about that. And yeah, meet Go players around us, get playing Go in person again. It's so close. Or maybe you're looking to buy a gift for that special Go player in your life, and you can go over here, as in, I'm sorry I completely missed the holidays, but hey, there's some cool stuff here anyway. I'll get you, my dear God. Dude. I mean, if you're a high roller and you've got $1,200 to spend, I was about to say cheap and affordable, with the exception of this thing. Holy crap, this thing is bonkers. Dude. All right, if you're a high roller and you're looking for a board that clearly says I'm a high roller, then, I mean, you can't go wrong whether you're looking for a super expensive set for $1,200 or a much cheaper set for $200. You know, whichever way you want to go, there's some pretty cool stuff over here. You might want to check it out. Baduk.club, you might want to go there and see what's what. Thank you, as always, in part to Baduk.club for sponsoring these videos. All right, Martin Gregory asks,
at 507, you said we are never going to kill that. But what if Black plays C11 instead of C9?
Ooh, that's a good question. Let's take a look at that one. C11. So the question was about this board position, where after White throws in, how is this going to live if, for example, instead of this is played, instead of that being played, it's played over in here instead. And I suppose you have me on a technicality here. I suppose you have a technicality. Yes, if the cut is on the inside, then it's possible, depending on how it's played, there might be a way to kill that actual stone. But short of that, I don't really see the issue here, because we have to cover, or he's getting out, right? And then if we Atari here, we've got to connect, or, you know, same thing. But this little stone is getting us out again. I think what you're worried about is this one. And you're right to worry about that when you'd be dead here. But, big but, what if we play here? What if we play here? Or maybe even here, and I look at it again. Yeah, what if we just play here, sorry. Then we do this one, right? But we are in fact out still. We got in, we lived and came out, and we cost us 2 stones. So you're always going to be able to invade this area. We can't look here and say, ooh, yeah, that's solid points for Black now. What do we do? It's like, no. Not happening. Absolutely not happening. You can find a way to live here. I promise. Radical Design says, I want to see a game of you versus Redmond. That could happen in 2021. I can look into that. I admit. I don't think... I haven't had much interaction with Redmond. That could be something that he might be interested to do as one content creator to another. But don't know how busy he is, so we'll have to wait and see. Got a comment from Mr. P. Whoop over here. I was wondering, do you ever do the double hane after being 3-3'd, and under what circumstances? For example, wouldn't having a Panuki facing the top right group be pretty good for them? Nani? Okay, so I don't think I can use this one as an example.
A dilemma.
Yeah, I think I can use this one as an example. When would I do a double hane? Well, long story short, I'm very, very... And I'll be going deeper into this in another video coming out, so if this doesn't quite touch your answer, then you can probably look for it in another video. But I'm very hesitant to do the double hane, because when I double hane, you expect this, right? As black, I'm expecting this one. So I'm taking my corner back in Gote, which is a problem because, you know, white can play wherever now. But there's also a future issue with this in that there's the drop down into this right here, right? Because if we ignore it, connected, dead stones in corner, very, very bad. So this is going to be sente. At that point, the question becomes, how much do I have in the corner? 2, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. I have a 10-point corner. In other words, my corner is less than a standard 3-4 corner enclosure, a small one. Meanwhile, white's getting some influence on the outside and a group on the outside. Like, maybe I can attack it. I don't know, but it just doesn't feel very good. Like, it gives you a solid point, but after that, it's just like, ugh, what are we doing with this? What are we doing with this? Like, it almost feels like you're compelled to try to make that area even larger, because you don't want your opponent, you know, coming out over here, because that hane is going to really hurt because of this one, not to mention that's still there. It's just kind of a headache, and most of the time when I contemplate it, I realize either I'm never doing anything down there ever again, or I'm going to be getting influence there anyway, then why don't I just go and grab the influence in the first place? That's a little bit more solid and doesn't have quite the same problems being left behind. So, yeah, double hane, I'm not really a fan of it in most circumstances. There might be a few variations where it's okay, but... Martin Oberg writes,
one thing I think you did less this year than promise was to ignore white small knight in the corner after a small knight approach.
Okay. That is fair. That is fair. I was going to make this the year of doing that. But the problem is, I just got to a point where I just didn't even see a reason to ignore it. Like, I was fine most of the time just going into here and being like, all right, I get that. That's cool. A lot of times, I've also found in games where I ignore this and play away, they'll immediately hit the 3-3, and it's just like, no, this isn't the right time for that. Like, it's not even sente, because even if you get an attack on this one, I'm still going to be fine and then get another move elsewhere. So you can see here in this particular position, I got corner, corner, and Sanrinsei from someone playing this too early into, like, trying to attack it and giving me sente again to make the base so they're okay. And that felt weird. It felt like we're kind of like getting ahead really, really cheaply, just because there are some people that don't know that the 3-3 is too early. imagine that being a problem this year, huh? Whew. Yeah. David Smolin asks, can you share your OGS user ID so we can download the SGF? Well,
oh, you stole away territory for free. You took
well.
Ho ho ho! I know what Santa's bringing you for Christmas. Glasses, because my dude,
my guy, my OGS ID is literally on the screen in front of you. Make sure reading glasses are on your wish list this year. I hope you get them. Kitsch Channel says, eventually Bats is going to have to write a book called something like Basics, a Haidan amateur's perspective for scrums, along with having straight up normal board position showing examples. And I mean, yeah, actually, one of the things that I do want to do is write a Go book. That's on my list of things to do. It keeps getting pushed back. I briefly started it. I think I've probably got a couple of chapters done. But yeah, overall, that's probably something I should focus on in 2021. Mm-hmm. No, you're right. I do want to finish that up and see about getting it pushed out there. Because, you know, it's pretty easy to self-publish on things like Amazon or whatever these days. So, yeah, I do want to do that. You're right. DB Richardson says, thanks for the Back to Basics videos. More or less. Entertaining at White 126 when you said poke out his eye shape. I was bewildered. I don't know how to see such a poke. So we're talking about around here. We have a timestamp. And this right here is a very fascinating thing to look at if you can see it on the screen properly. And what do you know now what we can? So when we're looking at a board position like this, let's go back one move so we can look at it empty. Get off the thanks to you. So we're looking at here, right? And what do we have? What do we actually have? We have potentially one eye that black can make. So from that position, we can imagine that we can, it's safe to play a move over in here, which you can't see. Let's make that darker. It's safe to play a move over in here. And that means he has to go kind of towards the left. So if we have a stone over there, we can picture a kill. Because he doesn't have an eye definitively formed right now, he has to spend an entire move to make one, or he has to go for a larger shape to make two, but then that leaves a throw-in potential. So you start to entertain the notion, if they have not formed a solid eye yet, they're not alive until proven otherwise. Even right now, where my mouse, where my this little square is on the board, you can see it's probably safe to even play that move, falsifying this little guy. And if that's not a true eye, it's even harder to make life. That's what we're referring to as eye shape. His eye shape is all completely nice and open, and there are ways to kind of just like get in there and start poking at those things. So it's like Monka, is he really alive, you know? That's what we're looking at. The hallmarks of a life and death problem are essentially straightforward, right? We've got a group that's completely surrounded, well, with the exception of like this, right? We've got a group that's almost completely surrounded. So if we can just finish off this little dotted area, then he's completely surrounded and needs two eyes. So he's a life and death problem. That's what we're looking for. That's all. Here's a tricky question from BT Malik. I have a question. You invested 20 stones in the middle trying to get a second eye before you did the Hani at B10, securing the left-hand side. How could you be sure the gain on the left is bigger than the loss in the middle? Estimated the gain to be about 50 points with 20 points invested. Shouldn't you have stopped trying to attempt to get A? I think what he's referring to, if we look over at this, is the fact that I ran out. Yeah, back here, we had this wonderful game where my opponent was trying very, very hard to kill my group. And rather than just go here and, you know, kill him and be alive, I ran out into the center and instead tried to get my eye over here rather than go back and play over in here. Now, the idea here is, yeah, I have an emergency move over here to live whenever I want. But at the same time, going out into the middle, threatening eye shape over and over and over again, it's kind of like me eye. Like right now, I can kill two stones, or I can kill here and get an eye. So I can do this, or I can do this. And right now, being in the middle is good because this is his only hope to win this game, the territory in here. So cool, me eye, this or this. He responds. So I come out again. Now I'm threatening to come out, I'm threatening to get a shape over here, or whatever. He can save in Gote, but we've got ways to get eyes again. So he pokes at that and says no. Keeps me disconnected, and I'm always looking for that me eye, like, okay, I can get another eye here, or I can get an eye over here, and so on, and so forth, and so on, and so forth. Got another comment here from Mitchell R. asking, how is this fun with no timestamp in a game where nothing terribly unusual happens? So I'm going to assume he either means either my attempt to rank up twice to 7 Don or Go in general. Either way, I think we found someone who's getting coal for Christmas. And lastly, we have C633-3374, who's asking, happens often in your videos that you mark some points with your tool, but when you get Sente, you make a completely different move. Can you elaborate why? E.g., at 525, what do the blue dots mean if they are not the best moves? For that, we are seeing over here. You see that I have gone ahead and highlighted some pretty big moves. You can cut through the small knight. You can go ahead and play here. You can invade here or here. These are all pretty big moves because they swing territory in one direction or the other. But there is a proverb that we must adhere to, which is that we play urgent moves before big moves. So even though there might be a big move, there might be a more urgent move that we want to play elsewhere. And that concept is what we're going to dive into right now. We're going to hop over onto OGS, where we look at games currently going on, where we discuss what is a big move that could have been played versus some urgent ones that maybe are or should have been played. And I'm sure the fine folks at OGS are not going to mind in any way, shape, or form that I'm going to be using their games as examples. So let's start down here where it's easiest to see these things, because it gets a little bit more murky the more we go up the ladder, which we are going to be doing. Take a look at a 14Q game. It's a double to Q game that is one of the furthest along. So let's take a look at what they're doing. Never mind, that's a 13 by 13. Take it back, we will not be looking at what they're doing. All right, so we've got a nice little 12Q versus 11Q game over here. Now, opening aside, we can immediately start considering what our large moves. You know, approaching the corner. So that's what we expect, approaching corners. Corner's been approached. We're leaning, so we're gonna respond. Despite the fact that it's still pretty big to approach corners, we don't want a stone to die, so we're going to answer that, okay. And Jiseki choices aside, here we have Sente as black. We can choose what we want to do. So we can imagine if we are black that something like maybe enclosing or approaching or splitting are probably good options. We probably don't want to play an influential game because of the wall we've already given our opponent. So we can anticipate something like one of these 4 points are going to be the largest point on the board. What does black do? All right, black's a giant jerk. So what white should be considering right now for himself is, ooh, if I get Sente, I can take one of the bigger points. But we don't want to do it immediately because, despite that these are the bigger points on the board, we don't want the stones way too close to our thickness to get off too easily. So it's more urgent to respond to this, use our thickness against the one stone, than to take one of the large points here. So we see what a pincer. We see a pincer. And then I'm assuming a jump. Though now it would still be okay for black to be like, you know what, that was just a probe. I'll do something about it later and go off and take, let's say, a larger point right now, rather than get into a jumping battle. Does black get into a jumping battle? Black gets into a jumping battle. White follows? White follows. Okay. Now we can't go off and play a bigger move. Because right now, one thing we don't want to do is get surrounded and probably kill. That would kind of suck. So even though we want to play a big point on the board, not being dead supersedes all of those other considerations. So black's going to probably go and try not to be dead. That's cute, but it's not a poke point, so we're probably going to go ahead and just enclose him now, or not. Ooh, responded. Bad move. That's a move that I would probably say was clicked really, really quickly because it looks like a cut, but maybe the DDKs aren't really familiar with what is and isn't a cut just yet, or maybe they played too fast. I don't know. But either way, that's a terrible move, and white should obviously cap it. And then we can go for large points for white, which are right now, I would say if we were looking for large points for white, we'd probably find them extending along the side here and using our newfound influence. Maybe enclosing here and doing something over in there. Maybe approaching like so. So that's what I would anticipate from white. It'd be really weird, for example, to see... Something like the turn or like the drop down right now, because they're kind of big in the corner, but there's much bigger moves available, so we wouldn't want to see those. Responds, black can unfortunately ignore that because black's already live in the corner, so we can take away the ability to be attacked here, make sure that we're fine. He responds, now white can do the big moves again. Now black can do the big moves again. Now white can do the big moves again. Okay, white's taking the big move there. I would go for the cap. Maybe I'm too aggressive, but I recognize that this is insanely huge. Like, this is just way bigly. Getting a complete surround, maybe a kill on these little three stones. So huge. That could be an urgent thing to do, to surround your opponent, because Go is called a surrounding game. Taking a big point is okay, but I suspect threatening a complete surround on the group is bigger because it seems more urgent before white for black, for example, decides to do something like maybe play more moves in here and start putting pressure on our group. Because then it would be urgent not to have this group suddenly die, so we might have to suddenly like play small moves to make sure that we're alive, right? So these are just between urgent before big. Urgent right now, also big. Use the Moyo. This is just bad direction of play going to the corner. So there is a good example of urgent before big. Right? And that's what we're mainly going to see here in games like this. When I'm highlighting something, but they're not being played for like 100 years, that's what we're talking about. Let's look at another DDK game. An example, good old urgent before big. Let's go ahead and review this game, see what happened in it. Looks like we've got double three. Okay, odd moves. Splitting is okay. It's bigger to approach the corner, so should have. Is okay. Weird Jiseki stuff aside, we've got a corner resolve. And right now, this turn admittedly is big, but I would say that enclosing is bigger. Not a good example of urgent before big, however. That's just slow. And that's bad direction because it's on the smallest side. Whereas enclosing or approaching from here is bigger. Not really a good example of urgent before big just yet in this game, it looks like. Extending is bad, should have just gone in connected. Okay, here we're getting into things. Right now it's urgent for white to get a base after white encloses. Black needs a base. But it's big. Like if we were looking at what are big moves for black right now, we would be like, well, okay, this is big for black. This is big for black. Like, we're getting to approach corners, things like that. But we're probably not going to play either of those after the enclosure because we need a base. It's more urgent for us rather than to play here to prevent ourselves from being, like, severely attacked and allowing white to expand. So it's more urgent to get a base here, even though it means our opponent might be able to get a big move. Is this starting to make more sense? any cutting points. Don't let Hana head of 2 and 3. Again, it's the same thing, right? We want to play here as white. But at the same time, we don't want black to Hane at the head of 2 and 3 stones and wind up completely surrounding our group and then like expanding, because you start to see like what's being developed here as a result of allowing the proverb to take place, allowing our opponent to start building off into the middle. It gets really, really awkward really, really quickly. So it is more urgent to extend again. That way our opponent can't do that sort of thing. See how all this makes sense? See how all this makes sense? Let's go and hop up to 5 queues and maybe 5 or 6 queues and look at some urgent before big moves in their games. But all right, we're in a 6 queue game. Let's see what we can see in this game. While we give everyone the gift of understanding urgent before big. Taking some big points in the beginning of the game. Because pretty much big for either player to like just... Okay, let's just not commit to a color here. It's pretty big for either player to approach or enclose, you know? These are the real big points right now. These are halfway points. They're okay, but whatever. This is also what you don't want to do with white, because he's building a framework game against someone who's going to literally get there first. So this is just kind of bad. Okay, that's not really an approach, and that, I don't even know what that is. So it's urgent to respond. He did respond, so okay. I'll give him partial credit. Here's another free gift. If you are a player who is looking at these weird shoulder hits by black and saying there's nothing wrong with them, I play them myself. Stop. Just stop. Because this is bad. You're hurting your stone. There's a whole bunch of complications that's going to arise from it, and you're going to be very, very unhappy. These are very bad moves. Though it is urgent, like I mentioned, to approach, or that's big, sorry, to approach, it's more urgent for white to not allow black to turn that into a good move by, let's say, being able to follow up. Because now it's like black already had a move here and white shoulder hit it, so black's responding. That actually makes sense. That's perfectly legitimate. White already having a move here and black playing this little under thingy on the other hand is not a legitimate move. So responding, because we respond to shoulders, attachments, caps, and other things that I can't think of right now, that is urgent rather than the big move of approaching or enclosing a corner. So once again, we're seeing great examples of urgent before big. Seriously, what the... Is he trolling? But yeah, right now, following up, making sure these little one stones that have just apparently signed the suicide pact to just not be alive anymore is the biggest thing on the board, not the approaches right now. Not a lot to say about this game. Let's look at another. All right, here we're looking at a 5Q game. Approaching is big for both sides. So we see approach or to approach. That's fine. Responded, a little bit slow, can approach or not, sure. So far, nothing too unusual here. Sorry about the coordinates, by the way. Just realized the entire video, my coordinates have also been on the board, so... That's a thing. All right, yeah, seems fine. 3-on-1, it's bigger to actually play away right now, weirdly enough. In the opening 3v1, we leave it for mid-game.
If our opponent plays here, for example, we can go off and play this one. It's not the end of the world. But alright, he's responding and settling, I guess. You can see this is why, like, we can live here, obviously, if we play here again, but it's giving away too much on a completely empty board, so it's actually bigger to play a bigger move elsewhere. This isn't really urgent until mid-game. And easy way to remember that is just 3v1, you can dodge. 2v1, you can respond to. That's all you approach, right? It's 1v1, they pincer you, it's 2v1, you respond, it's 2v2. But if you approach, it's 1v1, they pincer you, it's 2v1, you play elsewhere, they follow up again, now it's 3v1. You probably want to continue whatever else you were doing elsewhere on the board. So yeah, look at all this is being given away for free. This is the heart of that comment right now. Like right now, this was just given away just by virtue of just not living. So tell me what's larger. Tell me what's larger. Black getting all of this, right? Black getting all of this. Or you playing away. And instead, black getting this. Right? We know the answer to that question. By the way, the stone's not actually dead yet. 2 doesn't definitively kill this. There's Samaji here remaining. But yeah, you can get the idea, right? What's larger? This side here, or this side here? It's obviously this side. Obviously this side. So this is not good value. Not good value. Awkward. I would play here. That way there's no real reasonable invasion point. Here, there is. Kind of awkward. Kind of sad. I'm responding to good. I like it. Gote now. Again. Urgent before big. Okay. He defended the cutting point. I like it. But this cutting point isn't urgent because it's just one stone. So we should play away. Technically, that is playing away. I'll give it to him. And now white should be prioritizing a big move. There's no real urgent moves for white right now. So we want Sente to play the enclosure here. Enclose. Okay. Is that really urgent right now? Is it? Is it really? I would go ahead and say that making certain that we're not going to get this territory completely removed off the board, since it's a lot of points right now, probably more urgent than the Atari of the one stone into the drop down, right? Dropping down now? Ooh, not dropping down now. If you're going to do the Atari, you got to drop down, unfortunately. It's actually urgent to drop down, because while you are doing this, what you've just left your opponent to be able to do is this. So you're trying to get away with the getting rid of the influence, but you left the other stuff behind. So we're still going to get pretty strong out of this deal. So, awkward. Does white see it? Oh, white doesn't see it, and instead drop down in Gote. Now, it's urgent to not be surrounded, so black should jump out. Ooh, and black followed up. It is a big move. It secures that corner territory. But we can imagine quite easily that we don't want to get completely surrounded here, do we? Probably not, right? Like, life and death aside, we generally don't want to be surrounded because Go is called a surrounding game, and having that happen to you is a bit of a problem. So the urgent move before the big territorial move, because yeah, you know, white can play here and white still has the cut and stuff like that, but making sure we're out is more urgent. Making sure that we are not being surrounded is more urgent than the territory move in the corner, even if it's going to come at a bit of a loss. So yeah, as you can see from this, same thing here, we're behind enemy lines. Making certain that we're not behind enemy lines is urgent. Yes, it is a big move. And I would highlight this if I was playing, saying, okay, as white, I want to get in this move, and I maybe want to get in this move right now. Like, or maybe even the Hane here. I would be highlighting these as big moves. But right now, we're behind enemy lines. The largest thing we could do right now is just not be friggin' surrounded. So I would be playing none of them. So I can do the urgent one first. I hope all of this urgent before big is really starting to make sense. Let's kick things up a notch and look at a 1Q or 1-dot game. As luck would have it, I found a 1Q versus a 1-dot game. 1-dot is currently white. Let's look at their mistakes in not recognizing urgent before big. Ooh, that's going to be, okay, 5-4 point. Ooh, double oof. All right, so it is big to approach a corner, that is true. But unless you know specifically what you're doing with that and you've got a plan and, you know, stuff that you want to do, it's probably bigger to actually take a corner for yourself. This is just a little strange. Like, what do you imagine is going to happen here? White's going to enclose. You need a base, so we get to get a free corner again. And then you need a corner, and then you get to be attacked. Like, this is just weird, you know? Again, strange, but all right. Again, it's big to approach this, I agree, but it's probably more urgent to take your corner enclosure. Just a corner before white can. Because if white gets sent here and takes this, then white has three freaking corners for free, potentially. Jumping out. Okay. Urgent not to be surrounded. Now you might want to also cap his so he can't jump and we get like this dumb jumping capture race kind of doodad. Okay, I see what you're doing. It's not really an issue there. Like, you could just play here and save that for later. Because, I mean, this is nothing. Right? Like, what are you going to do? Oops, sorry, not that. What are you going to do? Be like, I'm killing you! It's like, you know, you're not. Alright, we're getting shape. Probably Sente now for black to take a corner because we can take the two stones or extend Mii or take the two stones. That's fine too. You literally just made shape. I would say it's probably better to take the corner or to maybe enclose that one or something. All right. Important to make sure we're not going to get into like a little jumping race. So turning's pretty urgent. Going after the corner that your opponent already has, not so much. Look, again, if we lose Sente here, which we might, and our opponent gets a free corner, that's pretty big. That's pretty big. I don't think this was urgent. I don't think this was more urgent than this one. Getting shape is pretty urgent, I'll agree. Okay. Not my favorite Jiseki, but sure. Not my favorite Jiseki, but okay. For some reason, white wants the outside. Now it's very, very big and urgent to block the extension from the enclosure. Okay, there is the turn here into the Atari, into a descent or whatever. Okay. This is not urgent. The minute white loses Sente and black gets this big move, oof. So this is big and urgent to prevent. This is big and urgent. So black just needs to prioritize Sente. Literally, what do you... Ooh, no, 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 don't do this. Okay. So I see the desire. I see the desire. I get it. Yeah. Uh-huh. Trying to harass. Makes sense. Mm-hmm. 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 As you can see, we're making a couple of points. But now we've got a weak group that we can attack. Best we can do is double Hane here. I think it's more urgent to save these cutting stones if you want this to be an even result, is what I would say. Otherwise, why did we do this? But alright, following up. Could probably take a tiger mouth here, but it's just meh. Hane there is better. You're running your opponent into your own stone. Oh, what are we doing? So, here's another great example. Well, okay, yeah, I guess it's urgent. Sure. Kill off the three. Sir? It is urgent for you not to die on top of the board right now. Yes, the Hane is big. Hane at head of two and three stones, always big. Making sure we're not dead, little bit bigger. I would say a little bit bigger. Little bit bigger. Now it's time for Black to be sad this game, because the stones are going to die. On an insanely huge scale. Saving this Ascente. Then we get to play here. And I would straight up potentially resign as Black right now. Because this isn't going to go well. There's nothing that's going to happen here that you're going to like. Like, you can try to run, but it's going to suck. But yeah, this would just be game. I have no idea what Black would do here with Hedgehog Time. And that's because it's big to high head two and three stones, but it's urgent to make sure your stones aren't going to die. That is way more urgent. Oof. What? What are you afraid of? Nothing here works. What is it? Your opponent going to play here? No. Your opponent going to ladder you? No. Weird to give up the stones. Very, very strange. Very, very strange. Alright, top's dead. That's game. Because our opponent's just going to go ahead and literally live like right now. So the entire top is white. And yeah, that's it. So I hope you have a better understanding of urgent before big and why I might be marking big stones on the game and not playing them. It's because it's not urgent to play them. It's a big move. I want to get in big moves, but as you can see, not at the cost of ignoring the urgent ones, because that carries a large price to it. Usually, believe it or not, usually a larger price than the big move. So I hope you have understood the concept of urgent before big now. Hope you understand a bit more why I might mark something on the board and then never play it. And yeah, I hope you can use this concept in your own games and it makes it a little bit easier for you to find the moves that you are looking for. And as you can see, players at all ranks, from DDQs all the way up to the one dons that we're seeing here, everyone makes the mistakes of playing, you know, a big move and kind of forgetting the urgent one, or like, well, you know, I'll play the urgent one later and not play the big move. And they very, very tongue-tied in trying to figure out when to play each. So it's always something you can work on to get that much better in your game. So good luck getting that much better in your game. I hope you enjoyed this video. Hope you're having a great holiday, and as always, I will see all of you fine people next time. Take care, everybody.